Okay, let's move over the room and I'm going to grab Adam. Some at the start. Very short snippets of works here. These are very detailed. It's an 18-minute long film that Adham has made for the exhibition, and it is quite epic. It's a big journey. I think we were just talking with Kaken about another reality that comes from within their work, and that actually they're interested in the fact we might be getting it wrong about how we react to what reality is. And I was sort of thinking about the movement that we see happening in the show, and that I started thinking about how this very simple, powerful idea in here that I didn't know whether you did this on purpose for the show, but movement, the movement down the river,
yeah.
And the movement of migration, of moving people, the idea of movement as performance, but being so political, and you know, that no thing can be unpolitical in a way. I just thought that was such a strong position within the whole exhibition that you say this is the natural thing to do, to move around, to adapt, to become
natural
part of
it. Natural is a difficult word for me.
Yes.
Yeah, I see where you're coming from and some of your
yes.
natural.
Like
that's a word that I consistently contest.
Okay, but I think it's like a. It's not an unnatural thing. Maybe we'll say that.
I like the parallel you're trying to draw, where a pre-existing definition of something and my lived experience don't seem to correspond. So where I talk about classification and taxonomy and language and how they don't fit with how I live in this place,
and
there might be some relationships with the other works through that is, I think, interesting.
Yeah.
And this, this work in a lot of ways, for me, ultimately, I'm the centre of that. My experience is the thing that pulled it together. But in a way, that's much, much more drawn back from previous works. I don't talk about myself as much with this work. It's more about the place and the River Lee that I've lived near for so long,
yeah.
And trying to make a physical journey down that river, but also to figure out all the so many different lives and communities that are intertwined and how they got there, you know, and how I'm situated within that. And there, it's maybe a little bit which is a migrant bird from multiple places, particularly the Lascars. I live very, very close to the River Lee, but it's maybe a mile or so away on the corner of Green Street, which is traditionally a very Asian and Afghan area. And being a person of colour, I'm from North Africa, it's interesting some of the ways that you are subsumed into local cultures. And I'm Muslim, but generally, I was raised Sunni Muslim, but the area is more Shia Muslim. So it's interesting how you end up relating to each other, but also getting overlaid onto each other and getting flattened onto each other by people outside of those communities, because there are many communities that build this area. So it's those kinds of tensions and the crunchiness of that somehow that it's interesting for me.
Yeah, that's what it feel about. There are certain boundaries, artificial boundaries that are formed, pitched as if they are natural boundaries. I think that's what's quite interesting.
Also the boundaries that are set up for a community or an individual's own survival. There's a lot of stickiness and tension and very little resolution. And that's really important.
I mean, there are these kind of really rich histories and narratives, and I think there's a kind of weaving of, you know, these references to the natural world, so whether that's Paris, or the landscape, or even the idea of the river. And I was thinking about this idea of the, you know, it's like sediments and layers, and thinking about tidal flow. I'm not sure if the river is tidal or not, but anyway. But like tidal flows, like kind of going out and bringing things in, and it feels like to me there's a kind of proposition here of a much more sophisticated idea of what might be nativist. Like inherently what's nativist is those different ebbs and flows and sediments over time through movements. And I think by presenting all these kind of intersecting narratives, it feels to me anyway, there's a kind of, like a real sort of challenge to that idea. Particularly things like plants, like these amazing plant references that you're kind of sort of giving. You know, people make all these assumptions about native plants, you know, and so often through migration or journeying or travelling or even just seeds or, you know, those things are far more complex. There's a kind of complexification. You know.
I enjoy the reading, this is a proposition for complexity. That's really welcome. Love that, and I think that one of the things I really enjoy, particularly with the plants, is where a plant is classified as native but is still undesirable down to its usage, down to its down to what it does, what it is to humans, you know, and that they in these videos somehow are, I hope, sometimes they're the protagonist, you know. So like I you know, when I'm working with the dancers, for example, like sometimes I'll say, you know, you are in this scene, you know, we're going to be dancing with this plant, and although you're here, it's not about you. So, you know, this, the, you know, the plant is the lead figure. You know? So that's been an interesting thing.
Could you talk a bit more about that process of working? Yeah. So it's Joseph and Omar.
Yeah, Joseph Funnel and Omar Jordan Phillips in this video. Yeah. And they, so we work on the choreography in a really collaborative way. I often will come to them with a proposition and a framework, and we have a conversation, and they will, and you know, we'll listen to music, we'll share stuff, we'll do all this outside. I mean, you know, we'll have like preparatory meetings, and I'll introduce them to, and I'll share all of the material in advance. But then, you know, we meet outside, we listen, and we try to figure out choreographic phrases, and they respond to the music, and we solidify that in something that can function as a launching point, you know, from a question essentially. So, you know, with this series of works, it was how do we produce points of contact and intimacy when we can't touch each other? You know, so there are synchronicities that we produce, and you know, while I'm doing the camera work, I'm also kind of directing them, and they're responding to the camera as a viewer, understanding what their body is visible. That's performance for camera. So, you know, I'll be saying, like, Joseph, find Omar, and they'll perform the phrase in synchronicity for a while. Omar, move off, and we'll kind of improvise for a while, and then they'll find each other again. And that's kind of how it works. There's an improvisatory quality to it. A lot of the ideas are very much theirs, and they're credited as choreographers in this. It's a very, very collaborative process.
And was there sort of a process of mapping specific locations? Because, you know, we get, you know, they're in the river sometimes, we get these meadows, there's, you know, images of Docklands. I wonder how prescribed that was, or was that so just a...
It relates to what Gavin was saying, as in a sense of moving down the river, and it actually goes... It goes to the end of the river and then back. So the Docklands bit is the Lascar section. So I kind of think of the structure of this as chapters, essentially. And chapter three is the Lascars, and they had a relationship to Docklands. So a lot of that is filmed, like, it's filmed around Canning Town and at the Lee Mouth at Trinity Boy Wharf. So, you know, and then they move back for the subsequent section for Parakeets happens, although that's mostly found footage. It's that happens in the Happy Marshes. similarly, that the end section, that's filmed around the marshes.
There was an earlier title that you were playing with as well, which I think was straight. It was just more a description, and it was something like, or was that the previous version of Dancing with
Clowns? No, that was the test.
That was the title of the test.
Okay. I don't remember the title of the test actually.
Yeah, that changed as well. It was an impulse at the start, wasn't it? Too.
Also, that test was not it was not filmed for this. It was filmed for the first video, because this is kind of become part of the series, and this is the third video. That the test that we did for the initial loop.
For loop TV.
Yeah, was for the first video, so that was shot around the ones of flats.
Yeah. But you were able to explore that sense to move it on from there. I mean, that's what...
Yeah, very much so.
Interesting with a lot of the works, to see how things have evolved over time. From those very early conversations, just those impulses. But it still feels so quite very, very direct. It became even more and more and more about those aspects of how to
about place and relationship to place and relationships with people and certain plants. I'm trying not to go too much into the earlier works because it's complex and emotionally sticky, but yeah.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I suppose that, yeah. That's a good description, maybe, of all of your work. It is there. Do you want to say something about the music in there? Because that seems so particular as well. And also exploratory, like you're exploring different types of music. I don't know if it's stuff you already know and listen to, or do you seek it out particularly for the films?
I have been using a lot of mid-20th century French composition, particularly Henri Dutilleux, whose work has a really formal and very dissonant modernist quality, but it's also a very, very European sensibility, which was what was important to me. It has the way that I employ it essentially foregrounds a European mannerism, which denaturalizes some of the assumptions of the native, I hope. So that's kind of how I was thinking about sound. It's a way to produce context and a way to produce emotion and feeling, that you don't feel entirely at ease in these spaces or in these narratives. Nothing is stable.
And a final question. Just a little bit about I feel like a strong continuity between the three or four quite recent works, or works made over the last two years, year and a half, that have come together. Are you still exploring themes in here, or do you feel that
I mean, particularly in the last three works, it feels somehow like they're very much in the same territory, thinking about similar thematic areas, to the point that certain strategies get repeated but warped or utilized for different reasons, the ways that I might deal with a plant as a protagonist, or how I might explore the experience of a bird, but also the music, as you say, the editing and the ways that we have approached choreography and movement and how different bodies correspond to each other and how that's how that produces a story.
I mean, it feels like there's more to explore in a way, just because you've set that up. I want to see the next chapter.
I really like what you were saying about sediment. I think that's like a really good way of describing how I produce narrative in a way. It's like layer upon layer upon layer, and how this layer affects this layer, and how once you've reached the end of this durational viewing experience, you might have shifted how you feel, or how you relate, or how you respond to certain parts of the story and how they put together.
It's good. It's great. But thank you so much, Adam. Such an incredible contribution to the show. It's really special. So, thank you. Okay, we're going to move over to Samra Mianja over here. We're going to invite her across the room. Come over, Samra. So I thought there's a perfect segue here again, which was the sedimentation and the layering and the building and that, and I sort of want to explore a bit with you, Sandra, the whole process of how the work was coming through, because it feels like you have been actually carving out and pulling out works out of each layer that you've been going through, and there's a next and then another layer and another layer. It's a very interesting sequence for us to have been working alongside and catching up with and experiencing and seeing how it comes into the exhibition. So maybe, I don't know how, I mean, maybe there's a lot to describe there. But
yeah, let's go for it.
Yeah, go
that
for
was
it.
One of our improvisations yesterday, go for it.
It was.
Ruth said something quite funny, like, that was, it was funny but also, like, I think, sort of accurate. She said, you know, you push the improvisation in every kind of space that you're working in. You keep pushing it. And that has kind of, I suppose that has been central to the way that I've been working. But not just, I suppose, improvisation in a performative sense, but improvisation in relation to drawing. That one line to the next, to the next, to the next, and you just kind of keep borrowing down and down and up and round. But using that sort of thought process in relation to making, or into sounding, or singing, or living, the improvisation in drawing. Because this project started as a drawing project, really. Drawing in relation to performance, because I was improvising and thinking about this, one of the grounding sort of principles of my vocal improvisation practice, a sound that is of us, that is older than us, that runs through us. And that's what I really was sort of wanting to interrogate in the first chats that we had.
I should remember when you first came here, the first day.
Yeah.
And it's like you interrogated the building.
Yeah, the architect.
You like went round and made sounds at the building to see how it bounced back at you.
Yeah. And I was drawing, I was sort of like sounding, I spent literally the entire day sounding, drawing, feeling the space, the height of the space, the breadth of the space, where I could go, where I could be low, what my voice sounded like here. And I didn't know what that was going to contribute towards. So I sort of went away and started to work on these series of five scores, and the plan was to take them into a school because I specifically wanted to be sounding with children. I wanted to have a conversation with young people. And that was because the project kind of emerged out of this, you know, out of sort of several moments at once, but one being the passing of my father and thinking about not only my grief or feeling my grief, but also trying to understand what my younger brother was going through, it's like eight, and thinking that actually, you know, he's not alone in this moment. There are a lot of people, full stop, but young people who are living in a moment where death and mortality is, you know,
very visible.
Yeah, very visible. It's absolutely. And I, you know, I've had conversations with him, but I kind of wanted to, you know, extend that dialogue in a way. And use sound, use drawings and sounding. Sounding is a mode of interpretation, and drawing is the thing that we're engaging with to have that kind of dialogue.
And that was at Chandos Primary School. So you, I wasn't there. You invited the children to respond to your drawing.
Yeah, so I sort of held a space for a kind of workshop that's guided, you know, we warmed up and we kind of looked at the drawings. We had a period of time of sitting and, you know, what's the part that intrigues you in this drawing? What are the lines that confuse you? What do you not like? You know, what kind of, like, what looks like something you've seen before? All these very simple questions. And then they would just sit and draw them. It's like, right, that's your score now. That's your score. That's your sound. Now we need to think about what that sound is. Mm-hmm. And then we just did very simple things, like let's do it as quietly as we can. What would if this is quiet and this is loud, what is this? And what is this? So it's a kind of like a, you know, a really kind of playful conversation and just like, you know, holding them in, you can't get this wrong, it's your sound, it's yours. Yeah. It's yours, and now we're talking, we're having a discussion and we, I mean, this is, you know, slightly separate, but we play this really fun game, gibberish, where we're running around the room and we're just having a gibberish conversation. It needs to make sense in your head, but we don't need to communicate. And that was kind of like, you know, kind of something quite silky to bring us into. Now own your sound. You know what it is, right?
Yeah.
And that's where the trust lies. So that was the kind of, you know, the next sort of process. And then, you know, we had some chats. And Howard was like, what do you want to share, Samba? And that reframing of exhibition making was super helpful because it was less about what do you want to present, what do you want to exhibit. And all these words have a connection, but they are different. But what do you want to share? And this phrasing of let's be together kept coming in my drawings. It was like I kept writing that for whatever reason, let's be together. And thinking through the framework of Loop and the offerings of like through the process of Loop TV, which felt like a meeting actually of the artists. And it also a moment to interrogate my own process, you know, in relation to the other artists. And it was through a conversation that you were having with Phoebe, where there was a conversation about death and the process of dying, and I was thinking about my own sort of composting practice and how, you know, there is a death there, but things are still being nourished. There is still life in that moment of death. And trying to use that and that kind of framework to think about the moment at the school as being the performance, the moment where something has happened, and if that were to come in the gallery, actually it's kind of dead at that point, it's done.
Yeah.
But, you know, using that idea of composting, how can we, like, how can it decompose, how can those ideas kind of nourish us, still be here, in the way that Eastside's permanent collection of artworks, you know, the moment has passed, and yet they're still able to nourish us without that sort of context, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, I was sort of thinking, well, what am I going to do? And so I just sort of started with, you know, the sort of score itself, the larger score that I took to school was, you know, this size, 5 pages in a concertina.
But standing upright.
And
like
standing
a
upright.
Screen.
And then these are my dimensions. So I just came into the gallery and just took everything apart. You know, rolled up the paper, took all the staples out, put those in a bag, took all the nails out, took everything apart. And in that process of undoing, I was thinking about what is this decomposition? I was actually, decomposing them. And what then happens? How can these live and exist in this space? And then at some point I just thought, let's make some mic stands.
Yeah. Was that because of practicalities? That once you started carving and you found a place to turn the wood, was that you realised, oh, they can, they've got a similar potential, a possibility of a form?
I think I just felt like, what is going to hold, what can hold this meeting? Like, what can hold this moment? What can hold it? And actually, you know, in a way, quite literally, quite physically, like a microphone stand literally holds the sound, but
it holds your voice.
It does.
Yeah.
But now there's this kind of extra thing that I've been thinking about. Actually, microphone stands. I was speaking to a friend, Steve, who was saying, you know, microphone stands are supposed to be audibly silent. They're made to have these three kind of points. The plastic on the end is absorbing sound. The cradle itself is to make it kind of audibly silent. And I was saying something that they're also kind of visually silent. Mm. The black is similar to the black that, you know, prop hands wear in theatre to be invisible. And actually, I didn't want that. I wanted them to kind of hold the poetic that I've been rolling with, which has been these five mourner figures that I've written in a series of poems that are also in the show. And I wanted, you know, each of those was drawn with the poem. So just thinking, okay, hold on to the teeth, otherwise you'll fall out. Hold on. What would that be? Kneel on the gums of Walker's seat and look out at the show. You know, it needs to kind of command and hold the space. And I kind of went through the same process with each of them.
They sort of feel the poetry in them as objects. It is there, and it's great to hear that then spoken about. But I mean, having make sound into the microphones. You sort of feel it when you're bent, having to bend down and get into the zip, especially when other people are doing it. So I think I really like that idea that you've made another invitation. It's like a generous thing. Again, there is a new space, a new experience, and you are invited.
Absolutely. I mean, we had a kind of moment yesterday.
Yeah.
And it felt both like I was aware and kind of looking at you both whilst we're sounding and improvising, but I was also kind of in my own little microphone. I think I was here, you were here.
Yeah.
So we could make eye contact.
Yeah.
And how would you was sort of like down here? But we could kind of connect if we wanted to, but we could connect through the sound, or we could look.
Yeah.
And there are those options. And then there's the option of, I suppose, listening in and observing the animation and the poetry and the film over here. And
maybe it's worth just walking around to see that.
Yeah.
So that's what I think is really interesting. Each of the works has a different sort of, a different spatial relationship, a movement relationship of audience and performer. And so here, as the audience, you can be the one audience member who puts the headphones on and it becomes a soundtrack for the animations that are on screen. And that is quite an unusual
setup. The structure of that with, this staging, which is so much about the kind of communal and collective and coming together and jamming and improvising, and that also being quite public. And then that's what's generated by that sound is channeled into this one headphone that one person experiences in this kind of more intimate space with these animations. And so, similarly together, we're really interested in that sort of dichotomy between the public and
that we might be having. There's moments of very serious. There's also moments where you're really having fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then there's an intensity and a serious, heavy points and really important things going on in the first text. And then the second new animation has a different lightness to it. Opens up. That's all. That's sort of been improvised,
or
developed, and then just happened in the process of putting the final exhibition together.
Yeah. And I mean, what kind of sits in between the two? Because I think that's a really fair observation. What sits in between the first one, that was originally a trailer for Loop TV, and the second animation is the workshops in the schools, which was also an opportunity for me to learn. That was playful, that was, it was dynamic, it was funny, it was weird. And that sits in between. And so, and then there's this kind of like more kind of, it just, all the notation from the scores is embedded within this, and all the sort of like colouring and the textures and stuff are all images that I've been collecting throughout this project. But there's a lightness to it. I was really focused on this colour blue, and with this animation actually I just allow a breadth of kind of colours and gradients to just emerge and burst. But it also, in terms of this, what you were saying, Harold, about the kind of intimacy of the single headphone, I loved imagining just one person, and I loved watching people yesterday, just the one person sort of peeking over at this group of people, and sometimes feeling as though that sound was for them. And sometimes if we knew the person, we might bring that in, or we might kind of,
freak them out a little bit.
Yeah,
sometimes.
Just do something that was kind of edging towards them.
It's quite it's a gap and a sort of link at the same time, which is very interesting. We were thinking that we might make some noises then. So there is an invitation to you to come and to improvise.
Yes, come.
And to bring your perfect audience member to listen on headphones and take turns and swap. Maybe that's how we can. We should just. We'll make some sound. Thank you very much for coming and meeting all the amazing artists. And please come and experience the exhibition and the full volume of when it's all turned up together. And join in. Thank you. We'll just go and make some sounds.
I'm going to go low again.
Flowers, dusty green flowers.